So first I want to just do a little bit of a show of hands. What kinds of roles of people we have in the audience today? Do we have privacy professionals? Welcome. So I assume, are you legal professionals? Yeah? No? I know you're a privacist. do we have policymakers or former policymakers? Excellent. Security professionals, I'm assuming lots of folks. Identity professionals? Any external facing consumer customer identity professionals? Yay. Represent my peeps. Do we have folks who are digital transformation professionals or customer experience professionals? I know it may not be your usual conference to go to, but I'm talking about digital transformation here. Oh, a couple folks. Okay, this is very good to know. Is everybody aware that Data Privacy Day was January 28th, pretty recently, a couple and a half of weeks ago? So we celebrated Data Privacy Day. I actually went to an event at Twitter headquarters. You may have seen there was, you know, a bunch of talks. And typically the way that Data Privacy Day is kind of measured in terms of success is how much press it got. The question I always have is, what got better since last year? And I worry that not much got better. And so in terms of the consent part of privacy, in terms of what people usually think of as the part of privacy that matters to them, were they included in the proposition? What I'd like to talk about today is maybe taking a page out of Sister Hazel's playbook. So last year I actually gave a talk with Josh Alexander in which we performed a song about privacy. I tweeted it last night, you can check it out. I'm not gonna sing today. However, I'm going to now do a dramatic reading of some lyrics for you. This is my advice. If you wanna be somebody else, if you're tired of fighting battles with yourselves, if you wanna be somebody else, change your mind. I think we're sort of circling and circling around some challenges because we're not admitting realities about one component of privacy, maybe not the data protection component, but the part of privacy that goes along with what ordinary people, and we are all also ordinary people, I think, along with being professionals, that goes along with a saying that my standards colleagues and I have, which goes, privacy is context, control, choice, and respect. So I want to sort of prove that to you as we go along here. So first, what I want to do is define what I mean by digital transformation. You know, even if you're in the business of making something like outdoor clothing that's all about atoms, actually, increasingly, there's smart shirts and smart socks and so on, it's all about the bits. We know that supply chain management is all integrated with APIs now. IT processes all went off paper a long time ago. And users, increasingly, many users, expect to engage digitally in lots of different ways. So even if it is about atoms, it's about the bits. So that's really what I mean here. And so what are the consent-oriented privacy challenges in this picture? So first of all, let's take a look at what has changed with respect to our end users. And by that I mean citizens, patients, customers, consumers, the people that we need to interact with as we do business. Well, okay, not to put too fine a point on it, everybody's saying, post Snowden, things have changed. One concrete example that I'll give to you that's very recent, everybody paid attention to this. On, you know, day X, Evernote said this, and on day X plus one, guess what happened? Now, they didn't entirely walk back every single thing, but pre-Snowden, I don't think this would have happened. There's lots of examples, in fact. August 2015, we had Spotify changing its privacy policy and somebody noticing and going nuts on Twitter and all of social media and people sort of saying, well, you know, I have choices. I have Rhapsody and the new Apple Music and, you know, people being highly sensitized. Even in cases where businesses are not commoditized and do not have low switching costs, which in the main lots of businesses are, banks, telcos, lot of things, like Pokemon Go, when they had the Google single sign-on thing saying, oh, all of your data is available. Guess what? Nintendo was forced to change. So there is a sea change in people's savviness and cynicism, but still, everybody wants an omnichannel experience. You have to solve everything somehow. So this is a big challenge, which is, I want it all, I want it now, I want it free, I want it private, I want it sensitized to my needs. So that's one challenge. Another challenge is, what's going on in the innovation context, in the industry technology context? Well, forgive the stupid visual pun, we all need to achieve escape velocity with our innovation strategy. We must. We have to stay ahead of each competitor. And there's a whole bunch of new technologies. Well, some of them aren't new, APIs. Well, there's containerization. There's microservices and the microservice strategy that goes along with that. There's IoT. There's all kinds of new, well, maybe toys, maybe not toys, that inform how we can achieve innovation. Each one of those changes a user trust proposition, either at the front end with constrained interfaces or at the back end. I mean, if you look at microservices, how do they pass user context between them? There's a lot of questions there still. And then we come to blockchain. Now, blockchain has been a very hot topic, a hot conversation, so much so that I actually invented a drinking game. When somebody says blockchain, you drink, which, well, this week particularly, this is not hard to do, but you know, soon you'll be on the floor, actually, with blockchain. Oh, there, I said it again. Does anyone have a flask at 9:15? But you know, blockchain is actually deliberately trying to affect trust, and there's work in blockchain identity to affect it in a positive direction. We actually do not know the results of that work yet. I'm actually co-chair of a group called Blockchain and Smart Contracts, at a group called a .org called Kantara Initiative. I'll tell you more about that in a bit. Looking at this exact proposition, and the jury is out, I will tell you. So, and of course, you're doing this on no budget. So there's a challenge. Finally, you have the risk context, which is completely opposite to the previous slide. You've got all these technologies going on, you've got everything being put in the cloud, and a risk team, a DPO, looks at this and says, oh my god, that's just Swiss cheese and everything is leaking. There's holes. It's all coming out. You've got to play the don't put the CFO in jail strategy. And of course, there's the regulations, and they're constantly sometimes creeping forward and sometimes leaping forward. And we'll talk a little bit more about GDPR specifics in a bit. So, you know, the idea is to meet in the middle. You have to meet in the middle, and we've always struggled to meet in the middle. So here's a little bit more GDPR for you, some quotes from the preamble of GDPR. So, consent should not be regarded as freely given if the data subject has no genuine or free choice, or is unable to refuse or withdraw consent without detriment. Wow, that's a high bar. And then talking about no clear imbalance anymore. Another high bar. And then you've got the business starting to realize, well, of course we value personal data as an asset. And now I'm being aspirational here. Our customers' wishes have value. Yes, we want it. That's why we're building product. But that last bit, I'm saying, is aspirational. Our customers have their own reasons to share, not share, and mash up data, which we can address with value add. Well, there's opportunity there. How do we meet in the middle with that kind of thing? Well, I'm here to tell you it's possible. Now, how have we seen user consent to date? Well, it's a rather outmoded model, I suggest to you. I swear I tried to find an animation that would go wow, 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 but if anybody knows PowerPoint better than I, come on up later. So I've got a rather, let me give you some examples that, of course, you know intuitively about consent because you're a human being as well as a pro of whatever sort you are, but let me just, you know, walk through the examples quickly. opt-in consent, you typically experience this as a checkbox. And it kind of means when it's opt-in that, well, your choice is rather coarse-grained. You say yes, or you walk away from whatever the service is. Opt-out consent, oftentimes experienced as an email footer. That's your way of saying, oh, I might have said yes at one point, but this is how I can say no again. Implied consent is an interesting one, because that's one that GDPR has actually sort of ruled out of order. But this is one where if, this is just an email to a friend where I put my email address that I've carefully blocked out. Not that it's very secret, but if you put an email address in some communication with, say, some organization, it's sort of assumed that it's okay for them to use it because you put it there. That's a form of implied consent. Now, I put in cookie directive just because of the EU cookie directive, which does require consent. In this case, this is one of the, I found a top 10 good examples of doing the cookie directive, and Tesco was one. This is actually a browse wrap kind of version, so I don't know that that's that good. Although, I don't know about all the millions upon millions of pounds and dollars and whatever that have been spent implementing the cookie directive, what it does for privacy. Anyone? Bueller? But there you go, there's an example. So pretty much oversimplifying, the entire official world of consent looks like, well, this. So notice is what you're supposed to have to do before you have somebody consent. That's, you know, what they're consenting to. You have something like implied and expressed or explicit. GDPR gets a little bit more specific about unambiguous versus even the harder standard of explicit. And then opt-in and opt-out are the variants of when you're explicit. I suppose you can have implied versions of, no. Anyway, that's all exciting, but users are not very empowered thereby. So cookie directive is an example of, great, you informed me. What am I supposed to do about this? Well, not visit your site. Well, in the case of Tesco, you can't get very far. Not to pick on Tesco, I love them. So, little more detail here. So in the healthcare world, they did something really innovative and sophisticated. They have a notion of directives. So if you've ever onboarded to a new doctor and filled out a form saying, well, I wish to share certain kinds of information or all my information with my spouse or this person or this caregiver, that's an example of a consent directive. And if you've ever filled out something like a health power of attorney, an advance directive. Those are really interesting, because they kind of look like something you got to do all on your own. Nobody had to tell you necessarily what to do. To me, being in the identity and access management game, they smell like authorization policy. They're very empowering, in fact. So keep that in mind and remember it. And then we have notions of collection, use, for purpose, and disclosure. Those are, you know, ordinary English terms, but terms of art in the consent world. So again, oversimplifying a bit, but you know, that's the version of consent standing on one foot that I can give you here right now. And you know a lot about how regulations consider consent. People who, you know, do privacy for a living consider consent, and whether you meet a standard, and what does it have to do with what people consider to be, did you ask me and do I trust you? And that's if you bothered to ask them. What we're missing is actually some real life examples that speak to digital transformation challenges and whether people can come to trust you in the case where you didn't accidentally let slip some information, the data protection half. But you might have mindfully done something to make them not trust you. So let's look at one example. This is not a social example of a share button. Who uses Google Docs maybe in their personal life? Yeah, I do. So I'm in a band. I live in Seattle. There's a law. I don't want to be out of compliance with that law. And you know, my band uses it for our charts, for our music. This is actually an example of that. So you hit a share button, you get to choose who you share it with, Nobody told you, nobody asked you, nobody put you over a barrel to say, well, you don't get access to this data if you don't get access to the service if you don't say yes. I got to choose what to share, what kind of sharing is involved, and with whom I'm sharing. Well, is that opt-in? Is that opt-out? No. But it's permissioning of a very powerful sort. What about Android upgrades, where you get to choose what kind of access all the applications have to your mobile platform? When you think about that, you're looking at the grain of access into your very own OS. And it may not just be access to your data, it may be, but it may also be access to your camera, to do stuff with your camera. What about unattended package deliveries? Which, you know, this is an example from a little while ago, but this is getting more and more frequent in terms of what you can do. Now, a lot of people, particularly RSA attendees, may be getting the willies about this idea. People want to do this. And one of my principles is we should be finding a way. Companies are trying to find a way, and we should be finding a way to allow people to do what they want to do securely. So what you're seeing here is not primarily about data disclosure, although it may disclose the location of your car, if not the location of you. It's to get access to the trunk without giving them access to driving the car. There's use cases to do the reverse, too. So this is actually about API access of whatever sort. Disclosure is just the start of it. What about GA4GH's Atom machine-readable conditions for genomic data? That's unfair. But the explanation of the acronyms is right there in front of you. So GA4GH is the Global Alliance for Genomics and Health. And they have this project for automatable discovery and access matrix, meaning they're working on basically model clauses for permissioning of access to your genome. Why is this so important? Because your genome is highly non-volatile data. So if it gets out there, well, it doesn't sort of have a half-life. So if somebody does something untoward with it, it's really bad. It could be very highly sensitive. You know, people can discriminate against you based on certain facts about your body. And it's not, you're not the only sort of data subject. You know, it reveals facts about your family members. This sets you up for things like, let me blow it up even further there, you can actually leverage these model clause type things, that's my phrase, not theirs, I don't think, for usage in various systems, which I'll share with you in a bit, of what you could call user-submitted terms. You could actually control the purpose of use. So, again, have we thought of purpose of use in this way? No, we haven't. So, it's time to grow up and have a new sense of what consent, and I don't want to sort of bicker about the legal meaning of consent, but let's just maybe call it permission for now and run with that, because I want to bridge the divide between the risk view and the business view and just call it permissions. And by the way, that's actually a several years old Audi concept car, so that even picture is old, but it's awesome. I'm a big Audi fan. So if we get serious about context, control, choice, and respect, what might it look like? So I've worked this up. I've been sort of threatening to write a proper paper about this, and that's sort of imminent, and I invite those who are interested to maybe, you know, reach out to me and work on this. Let's look at what the modes would be. Directed mode is, can you give permission unilaterally? Reactive, opt-in, opt-out kind of models. Long-term, can you change your mind at will? Is there something like a dashboard function where you can see what you did and actually properly change it? If you look at the GDPR standard, it has to be as easy to withdraw consent as give it. That sort of almost demands a dashboard view. What are the methods for permission? Concrete is, well, I went and obviously gave permission. Is your permission experience directly connected to the result? And abstract is it indirectly connected to the result? So we might put implied in that bucket. And there's another example I'll show you in a moment. Scope. Can you control? Oh, so the controls are all important to say, can you control permission versus there are types of consent and permission where you can't control, and those are less interesting for user trust, for trusted digital relationships. So I don't want to call this disclosure. I want to broaden it because, as we saw, sometimes it's about much more. So anybody familiar with Settlers of Catan, the game? These are the resource cards. So, you know, sometimes it's not about disclosure. It's about grain, lumber, brick, wool, and ore. And you can do lots of, you know, you can do things to ore that you can't do to brick or grain, right? You can scythe grain. You can't scythe ore. Can you control who you're sharing with, the grantee? So in Android upgrades, you can't. With a share button, like in Google Docs, you can. That's the point of it. Oops. In environment is, can you control the external circumstances of the permitted action? Time of day that they can get access? Expiration date? Is the stock market above a certain point? There's lots of use cases for environment. Usage is basically purpose. Can you control the purpose? So can there be marketing usage of your information? How can they use the result of the permitted action, essentially? In healthcare, well, in the US anyway, they often talk about TPO, treatment, payment, and operations. So that's kind of like the functional medical and administrative use. And then downstream is, can I control whether the grantee can permit others to do actions? So with this framework, we can start describing what sorts of consent and what sorts of broadening permissions can start to increase user trust by handing over control where it's appropriate. And in fact, there's starting to be a whole new world of what I've been calling consent tech. Actually, a number of my standards colleagues and I use this name. So OAuth, the technology that is used for API security, and actually innovated around consent, has been around for some time now. It's in version 2 for some time now as well. OpenID Connect is an identity technology built right on top of it. User-managed access, UMA, this is something that I've innovated, does what it says on the tin, and I'll show you more in a second, is built on top of the previous two. Health Relationship Trust, HART, builds on top of the previous three, and a health relationship, health API, specializes in patient-centric, privacy-sensitive use cases for health data sharing. There's a group called Consent and Information Sharing at the same place where UMA is done that focuses on consent receipts and the user-submitted terms I mentioned earlier. So taken together, these address aspects that you see required in GDPR. Consent, proof of consent, data accuracy, data minimization, data quality. No time to go into all the subtleties of this right now, but major implications. And common accord is an interesting one because it enables you to codify the prose of legal terms in contracts and trust frameworks. So there's a lot of synergies among all of these. And so what I want to do now is work an example using user-managed access, so one of these that kind of rolls up many of the implications, with an actual real-life example, a real-life scenario that I'm working with right now. This is one of those done at the Kantara Initiative. This is a .org where standards, identity-related standards gets done. So what you're about to see is a scenario that involves a person, a patient slash consumer, sharing an IoT device, a smart scale, data coming from that smart scale, body scale, with their doctor. So you might have some sort of mobile-friendly app showing somebody standing on a scale and weighing themselves and saying, well, I want to selectively share some of that data with my doctor. Now we know from real life, you know, people have shared their Apple Watch data with their doctor. Actually, somebody seeing self-diagnosing signs that there was something with their heart. If you recall, about a year ago, this fellow noticed signs that he wasn't well, and he went to the hospital. And it turned out there was a problem with and he was admitted, and he had a shorter hospital stay as a result of the longitudinal data he was able to share. So there are real use cases for this, and as I say, this is a real life use case. The doctor view of data having been shared might be, well, not all the data is shared. Person's choice, because this is just a consumer product. How might that person have shared the data? And hopefully you can see what's going on here. The resource being shared is effectively the scale data, as exposed by the API of the manufacturer. He's sharing with, in this case, a person, the doctor, and he's sharing selectively what looks kind of like a Google Docs view. He's sharing selectively scopes. And ultimately, he's picked two of the scopes, not all three available. So this is one possible UX, one possible flow. This is a directed flow. Could have been other flows. And what you can see in this view is it's possible using UMA to manage all of the permissions and consents and whatever you may want to call them, authorizations, coming off of many different devices and who knows what, cloud file systems and other resources that person has in their life in a single place, in a single service. So kind of a dashboard view, that long-term mode. Remember, we talked about consent directives, and I asked you to remember it. That's actually, consent directives are, they're being standardized. They have been standardized at the organization HL7, the FHIR API I mentioned to you. This is what they look like in paper form. And they're used all the time in paper form. They're typically implemented, if they are yet at all, in proprietary form. So the work going on at the HART group that I actually co-chair, built on top of UMA and OAuth and OpenID Connect, is considered the path to interoperable, successful technical implementation in electronic form. And there's many other use cases for this entire model that I'm showing you, so not just healthcare, government to citizen, financial data sharing, if anybody's following like the open banking API initiative, and on and on. So one last thing about this kind of model, this user-managed access model, and I know this is an eye chart, but I'll just explain to you briefly. What you're seeing here is it's a graph of data. And the idea here is sometimes sharing access to your stuff is not convenient to do onesie twosie with a share button. Let's say you've got information available to you that represents your household. So the pink purple things there represents your kind of local address. The blue circles there are a household consisting of, let's see, Don, Betty, Sally, and Bobby Draper. And they're associated as Drapers. And Don and Betty are marked as homeowners. And the green bubbles there are the smart things in the home. So we've got a doorbell and a front door lock and light bulbs. And it's indicated through this information that the Drapers, all of them, can actually control the lights, but only the homeowners can control everything. So this can drive your permission policy effectively, because you wouldn't want to do it onesie twosie. Another use case might be, you know, you want your Airbnb renters to have limited access to your stuff only while they're renters. I always tell people I have 31 light bulbs in my house. If they were all smart light bulbs, I sure as heck wouldn't want to, you know, go, you know, let somebody get access to this light bulb, let somebody get access to this light bulb. So relationship-driven permissions. So just to summarize what we're seeing here, the capabilities of the architecture are such that directed, reactive, and long-term modes are possible, architecturally possible, and the design center makes them possible. Concrete and abstract methods are possible. Built into the design, scope is possible. Grantee is why it exists. environment as possible. And usage and downstream are a little bit interesting because it's possible technically through a mechanism called claims, and it functions like an opt-in. So basically all these years, Uma makes an Alice to Bob sharing mode possible, also Alice to Bob Co. Company or organization. So all these years, Alice has been clicking I agree. Now Alice can make Bob or Bob Co. click I agree, which I kind of like. and then finally, the downstream sharing control. I kind of say that it's possible technically in a closed ecosystem. In a more open ecosystem, deployment ecosystem, it's only possible in a technical sense, by layering technology. Otherwise, you're at a legal enforcement layer. So I want to close and leave enough time for any questions by talking about what you can do to build digital trusted relationships with your end users, whoever they are, no matter what your business model. The most robust and strategic option, as I like to say lately, is lean in to consent. So quite often, I've been seeing these articles by law firms, which are quite helpful when it comes to how to interpret GDPR. But some of the articles say, you know, GDPR defines consent as a little harder to attain than the other regulations. So you know what? We say, don't go for that standard. What? Really? That's not the sense of GDPR. I mean, yes, they did do that. And when I realized that, I thought, uh-oh. User trust hangs in the balance. But it's more than that. It's more than that. You're also losing access to call them dark relationships that people have with other people, with other services and with devices that you don't have access to. I mean, we've seen what's been happening to advertising models. I mean, do people even look at ads that they haven't yet turned off? Well, the arms race is terrible. And in the heterogeneous hooked up API world, we need access and we have to earn people's trust to get it. So if we've lost access to those channels that they're operating on, we're not going to get insight into what they want and need. So to change people's minds about us, we need to change our minds and give them more control. So, first of all, for those who are business owners, and we had a couple of people who were responsible for digital transformation, for digital business, for CX, you've got to engage proactively in regulatory shifts. There are tools out there, very nice tools, that say, here, we're selling to the DPO, just fill out this form. Oh my gosh. I mean, they're nice tools, but I don't think that's the way to go about it. Risk teams have got to recognize there's actually reasons for people to want to share. Lots and lots of use cases. Specifically, IoT brings it to the fore. When I first saw CareKit, Apple CareKit, there's an Alice to Dr. Bob sharing use case right there. And that was a long time ago now. So IoT and healthcare all mixed together are classic examples by now. Business owners start conceiving of personal data as a joint asset. In fact, the EU basis for privacy as a human right does it for you. In conversations that I've had with one of the key legal minds in Germany, actually, and he's been basically a DPO for hire for 14 years now. The way he puts it, you know, you can talk about data subject, data processor, data controller all you want, but the data subject is effectively another data controller and should be. So I just talked regulatorily there for a second, but this is what autonomy is about, and that's all people want. Sorry. And finally, go beyond policy to digital transformation consent tech. You know, I went to the IAPP seminar on Monday talking about, you know, the new technology of privacy, and I didn't actually hear anything about this. And I think this stuff is most exciting because it gives you tools for engaging with people and doing what they actually want, because believe you me, they don't want cookie directive stuff. I mean, I don't want it. Does anybody here actually want it as a human being? Crickets. So some advice about how you can apply what you've seen here today. Something you can actually do next week is whatever role you're in, reach out to the other roles. So some ideas of roles you might not have thought of: digital transformation, CX, payments, lots of flows there that they're planning where probably involve some consent or didn't involve consent that you might not have thought of. Some obvious ones: big data governance, privacy, DPO, risk management, security, legal, identity, operations. Okay, that's maybe one you didn't think of. Only because, particularly in big enterprises, so, you know, I come from identity and access management. One of the things people may not think about is you can't do something like right to be forgotten even if you don't know where all the identity profile data is. And, you know, my company deals with, some companies have over 1,000 applications and possibly that many repositories of user information. They can't possibly adhere to regulations, much less know how many consent flows and terms of service they have, unless they find it all first. And our job is to unify it. So the first step is unifying and clarifying. Step two is, you know, trying to get some transparency, and step three would be control. So next week, step one would be just finding who you need to talk to, and identity would be one. And sometimes identity lives in, you know, could be the risk side of the house, or it could be on sort of the business side of the house, or both. You know, by 3 months' time, you really need an as-built description of where consent flows live, or where nobody thought of consent or said, oh, we don't need it because it's not part of compliance. We actually took the lawyer's advice and didn't ask for consent. And so, you know, find the silos. Find the places where you have or don't have consent, or where you avoided it deliberately. That's a good place to talk to the risk team if you're not in it. Find the trust gaps. And this is a really interesting one because a lot of people don't, you know, they think of, well, the brand risk of, you know, data protection challenges and breach. But they don't think about user trust as a risk. And think about those delegation kind of use cases, share button use cases, because they're really just the other end of the continuum of opt-in, opt-out. And then the six-month advice here is just, it's really just on the way to, if you're susceptible to GDPR, that's a time frame where you can start to know what your requirements are for the building digital trust relationships ball of wax, as opposed to, I just see this as a compliance checkbox. So with that, I hope to entertain your questions. Thank you. We have about 5 minutes. Anything?
Hi. Thank you very much for the presentation. There is some confusion around, you know, what scenarios the consent is actually required in. For example, if you're like a large company and you have vendors versus partners versus non-affiliates, you know, who is the information going to, what your relationship is with them, and then what type of consent is actually needed for that scenario. So, you know, we got a framework from you. You know, what scenario is that for? You know,
Are you talking about data processor, kind of like who's a data processor, essentially?
Any type of company. You know, if you have a vendor relationship, in that case, you would not want to do this consent. right? But some of the regulations like web linking disclosures, they actually apply even if you have a vendor. So I think one of the areas is to figure out, you know, where it applies and where it does not, because if we go by the implied aspect, then pretty much everything is implied, right?
Well, when in doubt, I would say ask them if it's okay, because you're being transparent. You may have an opinion there. You look like you're about to answer.
No, I won't step on your parade.
Well, the reason I'm saying this is I've talked to some folks who have said one of the things that troubles us is that we have gathered consent for a low bar of a consent type, or we gather data without consent and we have it in our repositories, and now the regulations have changed, and now we have to go back and gather consent for data that was okay before that now is out of compliance. So basically, we have to go through a process, and it's possible to do that, right? I mean, you know, there's flows that, you know, I don't know. Consent that you didn't gather when setting up a profile, say, you know, in my identity world, you can always gather again when the person logs in next. But it adds friction to a flow, and it may make them suspicious. So if it's something that you already knew at the get-go is something that they may have a question about, being open with them and transparent, sort of eager transparency versus lazy transparency, may be the best way to go. That's sort of going beyond compliance is a strategic choice. So John, I know you have an opinion.
I'll invent one if I don't. So to that, in the B2B world, and you mentioned profiles, so that leads into my question. There are organizations who will have gotten personal data contractually. So legally, and that's one of the GDPR legal lawful processing. There's six reasons. One is consent. Yep. Another is contract. So if you're three layers deep in some kind of identity thing, but if you're a data aggregator, to, you know, evil Bobco, if you're a data aggregator and you're building what the GDPR would call a profile of an individual with automated processing, because you're gathering data, all of a sudden, you've never anticipated having a relationship with Alice, and now you have to. And that's a big change. You've got all this information about Alice, you've built a profile, she doesn't know who you are, and now you have to reach out to her.
So in summary, to get to another question, assess the user trust risk to make the decision, is what this strategy would say.
All right. You briefly mentioned the new payment services directive in Europe. How do you see that as a driver towards going to this direction with
it has similar effects, I would say, conceptually, as GDPR. And that's what I'm hearing. And I mentioned financial use cases as well, generally, because the need for consent has sort of the same basis in terms of respecting the bank and financial customers. And so the drive towards gathering consent is, it's very powerful and it's not changing. And the only thing that I see that is not a recognition yet is simply not understanding that the world of consent could be broadened and it could be powerful to the business. So it's all opt in, opt out, and nothing else. What does change that is the open banking API conversation, because it's driven by a bank customer looking to shop products, and that is basically a user-driven use case.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.